So the title of today's message, y'all ready for today's message?
Amen. Amen.
Y'all are going to love it. Jealousy and envy. Ooh. If you're taking notes, jealousy and envy. I'm sure that most of us can say at some point in our lives that we've experienced this negative emotion of jealousy and envy. How many of you can say that? We're all human. Amen. Amen? Somewhere in our lives, even little children experienced it with other siblings. Amen. So we know everybody here at some point has experienced jealousy and envy. But for the sake of teaching, even though we kind of know what it means, or we all really know what it means, I want to clarify with the definitions. So the definition of jealousy is this. The uneasiness felt due to suspicion, resentment, or fear of rivalry, especially in regards to love and affection. That's a definition of jealousy. The definition of envy is the feeling of resentment or discontentment of another's position or success. Where you see jealousy, you're probably going to see envy. Where you see envy, you're going to see jealousy. So these words are pretty much sisters, amen? Sisters in word, sisters in meaning, hallelujah? Amen. So there's one thing I want you to take away from today's message. If there's one thing I want you to learn, is that jealousy and envy are a dangerous, dangerous thing and a very harmful emotion. How many of y'all knew that?
Amen.
It's very dangerous. The Bible says, how do we know? Because the Bible says in Proverbs 14 and 30, that a peaceful heart leads to a healthy body. But jealousy is like cancer to the bones. Very dangerous to let jealousy and envy take root in your spirit. Amen?
Amen.
So today we're going to find out how jealousy and envy hurt a person, can hurt a person, can hurt a relationship, and can hurt a family. Everybody turn with me to Genesis. Go to chapter 30. Chapter 30. Jealousy and envy. What went on in this family? What was at the root of this family's problems here? Amen?
Amen.
Jealousy and envy. Y'all with me at Genesis chapter 30? Y'all are going to learn something about this family. I'm sure a lot of you have probably seen movies concerning the book of Genesis. You've probably read the book of Genesis at some point and read these stories or seen different things and heard different things, maybe in other churches, if you've come from other churches. So today we're going to study and continue to study the life of Jacob and his wives. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Genesis chapter 30. Jealousy and envy is the title of today's message. We're in Genesis 30 for those of you who have come in, so we can all be on the same page. Genesis chapter 30, verse 1, and it starts like this. When Rachel saw that she wasn't having any children for Jacob, she became jealous of her sister. Red flag. The first mistake she made as a woman of God is, what did she do? She began to see with her natural eye. She began to put her eyes on her circumstances, and she began to take her eyes off the only one that could help her. Why was she becoming jealous? It says because, you know, in the previous chapter, if you remember, in Genesis 29, her sister Leah began to have children and Rachel couldn't.
That's right.
See, Jacob had two wives. He's only supposed to have one wife, but their dad, Laban, tricked him by giving him the older sister after he worked 7 years and kind of deceived him, amen? And then he said, okay, I'm gonna marry the one I really love, which was Rachel. But he ended up having to marry Leah because Laban tricked him and then had to work 7 more years for Rachel. But Rachel is the one he really loved. He didn't love Leah the way he loved Rachel. So here she is. Rachel saw that she wasn't having any children for Jacob. She became jealous of her sister. Now, she was barren. And if you read through the Old Testament, you will find several women who were barren. They were infertile. And back then, in those days, it was a disgrace to be barren. But God used all these situations in these women's lives to show that he was in the miracle-working business.
Hallelujah.
If they would have just understood what God was trying to show them, instead of putting their eyes on their circumstances and trying to help God along to make things happen, things would have worked out a lot differently. Amen.
That's good.
So Rachel saw that she wasn't having any children for Jacob. She became jealous of her sister. It began to take root in her spirit, man. It began to take root in her body. She pleaded with her husband, Jacob, give me children or I'll die. She was throwing a temper tantrum. Lord, I want it now. And if you don't give it to me now, I'm going to go back into the world. If you don't give it to me now, I'm going to go back to drinking. What's the use of me serving you? I'm not getting everything I want. You said I'd be blessed. You said I was going to inherit everything that Abraham inherited. Where are all the blessings? Ooh. Why am I not seeing this yesterday?
Hallelujah.
I want my miracle yesterday. Hallelujah. Some miracles will come quicker than others. Some things you pray for and they happen quickly. Other things you pray for, they take a little bit longer. Raquel was in a faith walk and she was throwing a temper tantrum. You know, because Jacob loved her more than Leah, she was a spoiled little brat.
Amen.
Raquel was spoiled. She was going to have her way and that was it. So in the condition that she was in, you think God was going to bless her in that condition? Do you ever give a child something? If they're throwing a temper tantrum and then you reward them for the bad behavior, you'll create a monster, amen? You don't reward bad behavior. God's not going to reward her where she was in her heart. The attitude and the motive of her heart was to compete with her sister. She could have just taken a step back and loved her nephews and nieces that her sister was having, but no, she wanted her own. So jealousy and envy began to come into the family. This was already a mess as it was because he was married to two women. He said, well, how come, you know, God doesn't allow that today? Because y'all remember the Ten Commandments? Thou shalt not what? Commit adultery.
Amen.
It was a commandment that God instituted through the law of Moses, and it came later, and that's why God had to put that in, because there was a whole mess going on with people marrying more than one wife. And God allowed it to bring, you know, multiply the earth, but he didn't authorize it.
That's right.
Amen? So he used it for his glory. So these ladies here, this woman here is in a mess. So verse 2, then Jacob became furious with Raquel. He says, am I God? Now she's going to Jacob. She went to Jacob, give me children. He says, am I God? He asked. He's the one who's kept you from having children. In other words, for the sake of translation, he's not blaming God and coming against God. He's just saying, you need to turn to God for what you want, for your miracle.
Amen.
Not to man.
Amen.
You know, a lot of people want to lean on the arm of flesh, but the arm of flesh will fail you. But there's one that will never fail you, and that's God Almighty, El Shaddai, Adonai, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And, and Raquel
Amen.
Lost sight of that. And Jacob's trying to put her back on the track. Put her back on track toward Jesus, pointing her to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's what we do today as pastors, is we try to put y'all back on track, to put your eyes on Jesus, not on the things of this world. Amen.
Amen.
So then Raquel told him, take my maid Bilhah and sleep with her.
Oh.
She will bear children for me.
Oh, no.
And through her I can have a family too. Boy, that sounds familiar. Raquel is impatient. She has a bad attitude. She's with wrong motives in her heart. She's got a competitive spirit against her sister. I want you to go with me to Psalms 37. And I want you to see what God's word says about this. Raquel was in a bad way. Amen. She had lost her way. She was completely walking in the flesh. She wasn't walking in the spirit. And she put her eyes on the things of the world, on the carnal things, instead of on the one who could help her.
Praise God.
So 37 in verse 1. She's, you know, Raquel's jealous. She's envious. And you're going to see the destruction that it brings and the turmoil it brings in this family. It's already started.
Amen.
So verse 1, it says, don't worry about the wicked. Or envy those who do wrong. Who are the wicked? Well, it's the murderers, Pastor. It's the pedophiles, Pastor. It's the ones who are thieves. It's the ones who go out and hurt people and rob people. Those are obvious. But the wicked, those are the ones who just don't. They read the word and they turn away from it and they ignore what God says. They do the opposite of what the word says. That's what's wicked. Amen? So don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong. In other words, don't worry about the world. Don't worry about, don't even envy them. A lot of people envy rich people. You envy rich people and you're jealous of what they have. Don't envy the Donald Trumps. Don't envy all the Trump Towers and that he has a business probably in every country. Don't envy the Donald Trumps. They may have the reward in the earth in this lifetime, but the reward for us is in this one and in the next. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't envy the Beyoncés. Don't envy that. She's the queen of pop. And she's married to the king of hip-hop. Don't envy Jay-Z and Beyonce. Don't envy the fame. Don't envy the fame. And don't envy their fortune. Hallelujah. There's a greed that comes with that kind of blessing. That fame is not for the Christian. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Pastor Jesse told you all about a time when I was in a music group. He mentioned it. I've never mentioned it before, I guess. When you mentioned it, I had never mentioned it. But I was in a music group, and I remember being in this group in the 90s, and I remember opening. I'll just show you where I was so I can tell you how far God brought me the other direction. In 1996, I was in a group. It was two men and myself, and I was the head. I was the lead singer. And I remember they asked us to open for a very popular, at that time, her name was Cece Peniston. You ever heard of her? She was a big song, "Finally It Has Happened to Me." That song. They asked us to open for her. So she was a real big thing back then. So for us, that was like, wow, okay, we're going to open for her. So we opened for her. And then after that, there were some opportunities that came about to take us to, we want to go to Mexico. And it was just, doors were opening. And at that point, I guess a few years later, I'd been with the group about 3 years. And things, doors were opening. And in 1999, I gave my life completely to the Lord. And I dedicated it all in 1999. And then when I did that, I had a true encounter with God. Because I would go to practice, but I didn't feel the same.
Amen.
I didn't want the same things. I didn't want the fame. I didn't want the fortune. I didn't want to be noticed. I didn't want any of that. I remember being on stage and doing those, shaking and baking and doing all those dance moves like Beyonce, I would wear clothes. She doesn't wear clothes. But anyway, she didn't wear any clothes. She's half dressed. But no, I was dressed. But still, I was, doing all my thing and thinking that was what I was supposed to be doing, and that, you get real vain and puffed up, and you think you're all that. It comes with a price, that kind of fame.
Amen.
And that kind of people noticing you and telling you how great you sing. And I was like, Lord, that was literally pulled out of me from the root.
Hallelujah.
1999, I was done. I said, I had a contract too. I was signed a contract. I had done already a record. At the time, they used the records to spin in the clubs. The DJs would go for your records, they'd spin them in the clubs, and you'd hear them, and then they'd become, more popular, whatever the groups would. But, we did the record, we did two songs, front and back, and after that, I said, I'm gonna quit, and I'm gonna ask, God for mercy, because I don't want to be in this group. I don't know how I'm gonna get out of it. I don't know what I'm gonna do, because you're tied to the contract. They released me from the contract. I didn't have to pay. I didn't get penalized. I didn't get sued.
Hallelujah.
I didn't get anything.
Woo.
And, the gift that I have, I'm not saying I sing like wonderful like anybody, because I don't. But I know that God's anointed me to sing and to bring some form of worship. And the gift that I had, didn't want to use it for the world. I wanted to use it for God's people and for His kingdom. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
God is truly, and I never regretted one moment when I left that group. I didn't regret it. I never looked back. And I just was so happy. I'm so happy that God saved me from that life.
Hallelujah.
So don't envy the Beyoncés.
Amen.
Don't envy. There's a price that comes with it. Beyoncé may think that shaking and baking and grooving and going is going to give her props in heaven. But I guarantee you all that stuff is going to be burned up as wood, hay, and stubble.
That's right.
Because it doesn't bring glory to God. It brings glory to herself.
That's right.
And I use her as an example only because I'm sure she's a wonderful lady and I'm sure she's nice. But I look at her because she came from Houston and she came out from the church. Shame on her parents for pulling her and those two girls out of the church.
Come on.
Where they were using their gift, sending them into the world, dressing them half naked and telling them that shaking and baking and all that fame. And now they're just chasing for that same fame, and it's just year after year.
Amen.
Entertainment is good, but it comes with a price. Entertainment's fun. We all like to watch entertainment. None of us are so holy that we've already arrived and we don't ever want to watch entertainment again. We all get entertained by things on television. Sure we do.
Amen.
But don't ever envy the people, the ball players that make multi. Don't ever envy them.
Come
it
on.
Comes with a price.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Beyoncé sold her soul for a morsel of food, and she thinks that God is blessing that. She's sadly mistaken.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Speak.
So don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong. For like grass, they soon fade away. Like spring flowers, they soon wither. But verse 3 says, trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper.
Woo.
Take delight in the Lord, church, and
Hallelujah.
He will give you your heart's desires.
Yes. Amen.
Delight yourself in the Lord, another translation says, and he will grant you the desires of your heart. Go to verse 5. Commit everything you do to the Lord. Everything you do. Trust him, and he will help you.
Amen.
Raquel was not trusting the Lord, so how could he help her? She had her trust in man. She had her trust. She was doing her own thing. She was out of the will of God. Go back with me to Genesis.
Amen.
So Raquel in verse 4, chapter 30, verse 4, Raquel gave her servant to Bilhah, to Jacob as a wife, and he slept with her. Bilhah became pregnant and presented him with a son. Raquel named him Dan, for she said, God has vindicated me. He has heard my request and given me a son. You know who else did that? Her husband's grandmother, Sarah. She went ahead and she couldn't wait on God, even though God told her he was going to give her a child. She didn't want to wait on God. She wanted to kind of help God along, thought he needed a little push. Go back with me to Genesis chapter 16. I'm going to show you where the first person that did this, where it all took place. It reminded me of this story when I read that. Because Sarah, everybody knows Sarah, Abram's wife, she did the same thing.
That's right.
She got ahead of God. And we know the story. She got ahead of God, had her son Ishmael, and it created a mess in the household. Amen?
Amen.
That was not the son of promise. That was the son, a son from the work of the flesh. 16 and 1. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had not been able to bear children for him, but she had an Egyptian servant named Hagar. So Sarai said to Abram, the Lord has prevented me from having children. Go and sleep with my servant. Perhaps I can have children through her. And Abraham agreed with Sarah's proposal. So Sarah, Abram's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian servant, and gave her to Abram as a wife. Wow. Isn't that what Raquel just did? Now Sarah has done that. She did that prior, obviously. But look where it took them. Y'all remember, we went through the whole chapter. They had Ishmael, and he created discord. Then Abram had to cut ties with him when he was about 17 and send him on his way. Go back with me to Genesis 30. Mm-hmm. So here's Raquel taking matters into her own hands, not being led by God, not being led by God's spirit, but being led by her flesh, her desperation, her wrong motives, and her unhealthy jealousy and envy that she was experiencing toward her sister. So it says here, Raquel named him Dan, for she said, God has vindicated me. God wasn't in that, but I will tell you this, God will take this mess and he will make a message out of it. Why? Because through this whole situation, the tribes of Israel were going to be born. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So it goes on to say this, it says, God has vindicated me. He has heard my request and given me a son. Then Bilhah, no, she gave herself a son. Then Bilhah became pregnant again and gave Jacob a second son. Raquel named him Naphtali, for she said, listen to this, I struggled hard with my sister and I'm winning.
Oh, wow.
Her motive of her heart, she was competing with her sister every time. No wonder God hadn't opened her womb yet, because she was in the wrong heart. And this unhealthy competitive spirit has come in to her, to this family, to Jacob's family. Do you know where I find the most unhealthy competitive spirit in this life today? In the area of sports.
Hallelujah.
I find it to be what sports is supposed to be, a little fun, turns into a fiasco. It turns into a bitter war. I see it on Facebook. The Dallas fans are against the Texan fans. And it all starts off as fun, and then it becomes personal. Then it becomes something that you hear, oh, well, just wait till somebody talks about your favorite team and see how you react. It brings in a very carnal spirit. It brings in a fleshly spirit. Brings in a worldly spirit. That's why we're sharing with you today, going forward, leave the sports conversations outside the door.
Hallelujah.
And the reason I say that is because when I'm sounding the alarm, that means that the enemy is going to use that very thing to destroy or divide a relationship.
That's right.
Amen.
You cannot base your relationships on a sports conversation or a sports thing that you like. It could be basketball, it could be baseball, it could be football, and then what happens, it starts off as fun and then it becomes personal. Why? Because jealousy, envy, rivalry, hostility, quarreling, it's all part of football. And the Bible says to come out from amongst them and be ye separate. It doesn't mean that Pastor Jess and I don't enjoy a sports situation here and there. But the church is not a sports arena.
Come on.
It's a church of the Most High God, and that conversation belongs outside on your personal time. I don't even encourage you to develop a relationship about sports with people of God, because the enemy will use that to divide and render you asunder.
That's right.
That's what the plan is of the devil. I'm obeying the Holy Ghost, because that's what, when I saw this, I said, that's what really stuck with me, was this competitive, unhealthy spirit that exists in the sports world. Mm. And it can take over. It can overtake you. It can consume you. And you can become so identified with that that you become that. And your everything that you speak about is about that very subject. It's very dangerous. Mm. I've experienced it even just a little bit. And I said, whoa, the sports thing is, you know, I think these are worse things, because these kinds of things that come in are subtle. They're not obvious like a murder or a theft. It's not obvious like that. These are not seen. They're behind doors, and they come in and slither in, just like they did here in Jacob's family. If it can happen in a patriarch's family, it can happen in a church family. Amen?
Oh, yeah.
So let your conversation in the church be of the word, the Lord, the message. I'm praying for you, sister. I'm praying for you, brother. Is there anything that you need? You know, let's connect. Let's go have a cup of coffee and read the word together. That's the kind of relationships you should be having outside the church, in fellowship and in peace, because the enemy will use anything he can. And I'm going to show you at the end of the service how that can happen. Amen.
Amen.
So this unhealthy, competitive spirit has come in to this family. Verse 9, meanwhile, Leah realized that she wasn't getting pregnant anymore. So here she goes. She took her servant Zilpah and gave her to Jacob as a wife. Soon Zilpah presented him with a son. Leah named him Gad, for she said, how fortunate I am. Then Zilpah gave Jacob a second son, and Leah named him Asher, for she said, what joy is mine. Now the other woman will celebrate with me. Now she's got an unhealthy, competitive spirit. Go with me to the book of James, James chapter 3. James chapter 3, and go to verse 14, starting at verse 14. Are we there? And if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. James chapter 4 chapter 3 and 14. But if you are bitterly jealous and there is selfish ambition in your heart, there's where Raquel missed it. Don't cover up the truth with boasting and lying. They're both, see, Raquel brought in them to the family, and now Leah and her are competing, and now they're boasting, well, I just had a son. I just had another son. Now I'm going to have a son. So there's a going back and forth. There's a war happening with these women. And you know that sports has a lot of that boasting in it? Boasting and pride and rivalry and hostility. And I was just, the whole time I was reading this, I said, I don't even know why I'm preaching this at this moment, but that's what jumped off the pages, because that's what strikes me in this season because of, you know, football season. So verse 15, for jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Such things are earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For wherever there's jealousy and selfish ambition, listen to this, there you will find disorder and evil of every kind. And one of the main disorders that comes in is discord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's go to jump down to chapter 4, verse 1. It says, what is causing the quarrels and fights among you? What is causing the quarrels and fights among you, Raquel? Leah? Don't they come from the evil desires at war within you? You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. Isn't that what Raquel was doing?
Amen.
You are jealous of what others have, but you can't get it. So you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. There it is right there. Raquel's not asking God for it. She went and asked her husband, and then she went and made it happen because God wasn't moving fast enough. And even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only with what will give you pleasure. Well, I want to make more money. I've been sowing, and I've been tithing and offering for several years, and I've been sowing, and I want to make more money. What's the motive of your heart? Well, the motive of my heart first is I want to buy mom a house. I want to buy dad a brand new motorcycle because he wants a motorcycle. And I don't know why he wants that, but that's what he wants. And I'm going to go buy my brother. I'm going to buy him a house. And I'm going to buy my sister a house. Well, you missed it already. God's not going to give you any kind of money like that because your motives are wrong. That's a lust for the pleasure. What would God do If you wanted more money and your heart was in the right place, the number one thing, I said, Lord, if you bless me with more money, the number one thing, church, house
Amen.
Of God.
Amen.
House of God. The kingdom of God. How can I bless the church? How can I bless the pastors? Pastors, what do you all need? Because the Lord has blessed me, and I just know that the Lord has called me to help you and bless you. And we've had that. We've had that in here. Many, many people here, several people here have been more than generous in their giving to us personally and to the church as a whole. So I thank God for as small as we are. This church is a prospering church.
Hallelujah.
This church is not the church of Smyrna, poor and no. It may look it because we don't have tons of people. But we're rich in spirit, number one.
Amen.
And the Lord, because our hearts are in the right place. And we don't teach you to chase after these things and chase after money like the pagans do. We teach you to chase after the heart of God.
Hallelujah.
And that's why God blesses y'all the way he does and sustains you the way he does.
Amen.
You don't have to be wealthy and rich to be spiritual. Hallelujah.
Mm.
God can bless you right where you are. The Bible says to be content in all things, whether I have much and whether I have little. And if you've ever had little, try to be content in that situation. Boy, you have to have some faith. Amen.
Amen.
So what's causing the quarrels among you and the fights? Don't they come from evil desires at war within you in James chapter 4? You want what you don't have. You scheme and kill to get it. So you're jealous of what others have, but you can't get it. So you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And when you do, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. Raquel's motives were all wrong. She wanted it for her own pleasure. What was the pleasure she wanted for? I'm sure she wanted children. But she wanted it to boast for her pride so that she could beat her sister. She didn't have to compete with her sister. Jacob didn't love Leah more than her. Wasn't that enough? Hallelujah. Go back with me to Genesis chapter 30. Jealousy and envy. All enjoying this so far?
Amen.
Jealousy and envy. So we have here in 12 and 13, continuous, unhealthy, ugly competition, division. It's escalating in verses 14 through 21. We're not going to read them in church, but you can read them at home. It continues to go on. And these ladies just don't know when to shut it down. Amen. So jump down to verse 22. Something happens. Y'all with me at verse 22?
Yes.
It says, then God remembered Raquel's plight. God remembered Raquel's plight. Something happened to Raquel. She must have just got tired of going back and forth and being in this condition, and she got her heart right with God. She put her eyes on him, and he kept her in perfect peace because she was trusting in him. Maybe something happened where the motive of her heart changed, and she began to be humble. The Bible says, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says in 1 Peter 2 and 1, so get rid of all evil behavior, be done with all deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, and all unkind speech. And in Song of Solomon chapter 8 says, for love is as strong as death, but jealousy is as cruel as the grave.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you all, I used to experience jealousy before I came to the Lord. Well, Pastor, I don't know how to get come out of this. I do have unhealthy jealous emotions, and they seem funny at first, but they can do a lot of harm in relationships. Jealous of this, jealous of that, who you're looking at. You know, it's not healthy. How do you get rid of this? You go to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
He helps you. The Holy Spirit comes in and he helps you. He helps you form fruit in you. We're going to go there in a minute. So God remembered Raquel's plight. You know that God remembers your prayers?
Hallelujah.
You think God has it because he hasn't answered all your prayers, that he's not listening or he's not remembering. He remembers. He may say no. He may say yes. Or he may say not right now.
Hallelujah.
He may say you need to go through some things because if I bless you in this manner, you may not be able to handle it.
Mm.
Hallelujah.
Mm.
I got to make sure the motive of your heart is right before I bless you with this kind of blessing. So verse 22, then God remembered Raquel's plight and answered her prayers by enabling her to have children. Now, if God can answer a prayer for someone like Raquel, can't God answer a prayer for us? We have Jesus. We have the entire Word of God. She didn't have all that.
Praise
we have the Holy Spirit in the earth leading us and guiding us, the Spirit of counsel, wonderful, counselor, helper. Hallelujah. He's the one who leads us. The Bible says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, we are the sons of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to be delivered from these negative emotions, jealousy, envy. And if you're going through that and you still go through that today, you may not have understood. I mean, you thought it was just normal. It's not.
Amen.
I remember the difference between before I got saved and after I got saved. I went through some things before I got married that jealousy was literally pulled out of me. It was literally just like the root pulled out. I don't experience those types of negative emotions. My husband can attest to this. My husband was a personal trainer. And people would ask, well, gosh, you know, your husband's, this was before we were pastors, growing in God, you know, your husband's in the personal training business, you know, and the supplement business. Don't you ever think, like, ever, you know, he's out there with all the gym people, don't you? I said, no.
Hallelujah. Praise
God. No. Because I know whom I serve. I know who God sent me. Nobody says we're perfect, but you have that surety and that knowing in your spirit that you're with the right
Hallelujah.
Person. And you don't have to worry about those things. Praise Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit helped me, and he began to take things out of me, those negative things, jealousy, envy, rivalries, hostilities, competitiveness. My husband and I have been on the other end of people trying to compete with us for a position in a church. Are you kidding me?
Hallelujah.
I wasn't worried about a position. I was worried about the Lord. I was worried about getting more in every class and Bible college and being in church 4 to 5 times a week. I wanted to live there. I didn't want to go home. That's how hungry we were. That's all I was worried about. And people come in and just want to steamroll you for a position. Are you kidding me? Mm. We're not even the pastors of the church. What do you want? So we went through that competition. It was very unhealthy. And we encounter Christians like that even to this day.
Amen.
Competing, unhealthy competitive spirit, a pride and a boasting. It's just ugly. Yes. So we just stay away from those people because they're toxic. Amen?
Amen.
So God answered Raquel's prayer. God's going to answer your prayer, whatever it is you're believing for.
Praise Jesus.
It's just a norm of the Lord, so he's going to answer that prayer.
Hallelujah.
Whatever you're believing for. There's something you're praying about. Lord says he's going to answer that prayer.
Amen. Mm.
Okay. She became pregnant, verse 23, Raquel, and gave birth to a son. Finally, God opened her womb. God has removed my disgrace, she said, and she named him Joseph. For she said, may the Lord add yet another son to my family.
Hallelujah.
That was God's doing. God, well, when you wait on God to do it, it may take a little longer, but once it comes to pass, oh, it's like heaven. It's heaven. He does it good. And when he does it, he doesn't come too early, doesn't come too late, but he's always what?
Right on time.
Right on time. Woo! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to close with this scripture. Go with me to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, starting at verse 19. Starting at verse 19. 5 and 19. Are we there? Galatians 5 and 19. It's after Galatians, after Corinthians. Everybody with me?
Amen.
You there? Say amen.
Amen.
On everybody's way, we're going to close with this area of scripture. Galatians 5, starting at 19. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility. How many know that horoscopes are sorcery?
That's right.
Yes.
Now, you go to the Chinese restaurant and they give you fortune cookies. If you open a fortune cookie, God's not going to strike you down. Okay? Fortune cookies, my husband and I have those. They're fun. You read them, you go, oh, ha, ha, ha. But horoscopes are not from God. They're considered sorcery, witchcraft, because you're being led by what's saying, and they're not giving glory to God. It doesn't come from Jesus. So you never want to be led by that. You want to be led by God's word. If you want to know more about you and God, read God's word, and that's how you become more closer to God and understand who you are. We've taught a class around here called the temperament class. My husband and I have went to Bible college, got our degree in the master's of counseling, and then we actually sat in on it again, and then we taught it several more times, and every time that we did the class, we learned something new about ourselves.
Amen.
Every single time over the years. We taught it here a couple years back, right? We stopped about a year and a half ago, something like that. And we learned something new about ourselves every single time. There was always something new because we were steadily growing, going from faith to faith and from glory to glory.
Hallelujah.
So you never stop learning. Amen? Amen. So, verse 19. When you follow sinful desires or the follow desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry. How many know that money can be an idol? People can be an idol.
That's right.
Don't idolize famous artists. Don't idolize them. Don't idolize ball players. Don't idolize them. That's idolatry. Mm. Sorcery. Hostility. Quarreling. Jealousy. Mm. I've seen so much quarreling on social media concerning football. It's just really sad how people can turn on each other and say ugly things about each other, and it's just, it's ugly, and it turns personal. And I've seen a lot of that. Outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension. How many know that these types of things lead to dissension? And it goes on to say division or discord, envy, there it is, drunkenness. How many know that drunkenness goes with a lot of sports things? You try watching a sports game without any alcohol, and you know, okay, it might go a little better, amen? I've been watching, you know, I really haven't. I started watching a few sports here and there over the last couple years, and it's fun, but we have to keep it in its perspective. So we'll watch a game, and then we won't watch some for several weeks because they draw up unhealthy emotions. Who's experienced that? Be honest. I've experienced that. I'm a pastor. And if I can experience that, I know you experience it if you're a sports person. Amen? So you have to take a step back, reassess it, push it aside, don't read anything about, and then just come and just have a fresh outlook. Amen? Because it can poison you. Amen. You see what happens here.
Come on.
With that unhealthy competition, competitive spirit, and division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living, everybody say living.
Living.
It doesn't say that anyone missing it. Living, if you're living this every single day or every single week, that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Verse 22. But the Holy Spirit produces, here's the remedy for the envy and the jealousy and all these unclean things and these sinful things. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love. Joy. Now notice how love is number one.
Amen.
Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Everybody, goodness. Say it with me. Faithfulness, gentleness, and what?
Self-control.
Hallelujah.
Self-control. Raquel did not have any self-control. And it opened the door for her sister not to have any self-control. She was bringing poison into the family and discord. It says there's no law against these things. Verse 24, we're going to finish here. To 26. Those who belong to Christ. Who belongs to Christ? We do. Have nailed the passions. How many know these are carnal passions? Mm-hmm. Carnal passions. We want to leave the world outside of the church. Amen. I come to church for 2 hours to get away from all the mess and the chaos.
Hallelujah.
I don't want to hear about this and about that and about who's doing this and who's doing that. Who's not doing this. I don't want to hear about it. I want to hear about somebody growing in God. God touched me. We had my husband's family come and say, God touched me last week. God touched me.
Hallelujah.
And had tears in his eyes. And then we're going to come and talk about sports in the middle of that. You know, do you know that that's the last thing people remember when they hit the door is going to be the sports team? They won't remember what was preached. Why? Because the enemy, the word is one thing that the enemy will come in and sit through and rattle it all up. And pretty soon you only got 5% of what you learned. We only probably get a small percent anyway, because the mind can only retain so much. But when you come in with the wrong conversations, it's just tears it all up. Amen? So we have to be mindful of these things. This is a holy place. This is the Kareem we used to talk about in a holy place. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Go down with me to verse 24. Those who belong to Christ have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. God nailed my passion for being famous many, many, many years ago to the cross. God nailed my passion for wanting vanity and thinking I was all that, nailed it to the cross.
Hallelujah.
I'm not all that. I'm only who I am because of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
I learned that I'm not all that. I learned that. And it's a good thing to learn. Not all that. We're not all that. You know, I used to say when you were in the world, you think you're all that in a bag of chips. Oh, yeah, Miss Thing, you think you're all that. You know, I used to do things. Well, we, you know, it's we still have fun. It's okay to have fun. Holy Ghost has a sense of humor. You all know we laugh in church sometimes. But sometimes we just got to put things in perspective. Amen? Everything's got to be in moderation. Hallelujah. So we've nailed our passions and desires of our sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. Our prophet, some of you have met the prophet that we used to be under a long time ago. He'd say, y'all got to hang on that cross until you're just crispy. When everything in the flesh is just killed out of you, you got to hang there until you're just crispy.
Like,
all dried up from the world. Hallelujah. And full of the Holy Ghost. It says, verse 25, since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Let us not become conceited Oh gosh, in the sports world, people become so conceited, it's so ugly. And they become provoking one another. Oh, my team's better than your team. Oh, this person's better than that person. Oh no. And it becomes so ugly. And we know that happened with Raquel. Well, I'm going to have a baby because you had two babies. Well, I'm going to have more because you just had some. It's so ugly, and they become jealous of one another. It's time to put jealousy and envy out the door. It's time to put everything that comes with jealousy and envy, every harmful emotion out the door. People kick. Amen.
Amen.
So in conclusion, say, well, Pastor, how do I overcome this negative, harmful emotion? What does the Bible say? The Bible says in James, humble yourselves before God. Humble yourselves in His sight, and He will lift you up. The only way you can do this, church, is if you draw near to Him.
Amen.
If you draw near to Him, He will draw near to you.
Amen.
But if you never draw near to God, how is He ever going to kill those passions that we have in our flesh? Because we know, we always learn, and we learn through the Word and Pastor Jesse's teachings a lot. He says, but the flesh is not saved. Our spirit man is saved. And we contend with this mortal body every day because it wants what it wants. It wants to do what God says not to do. And what we're supposed to not to do, we end up doing. And the Apostle Paul said that, and vice versa. We don't want to do sometimes what our flesh gives over to. Sins can be flagrant, they can be out, and they can be inward. That's why jealousy and envy is so dangerous. Because it comes in so subtle, it comes in through the back door, and it looks just harmless, but they're not. It destroys families, it destroys relationships, it destroys respect for one another, it destroys many, many things. Let's all stand to our feet.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing, but am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find.